outline this morning and today is very much about, it's about choices. It's about, the purpose of today is understanding what's available out there and how best can we use what's available out there to make sure that all of you have the control options that you need to manage this particular problem. I have to say, from having sat through this morning's session, I think there's been an absolute wealth of information. I certainly feel that I know an awful lot more about vine weevil than when I did my RHS certificate in horticulture. And the great thing is we've now got an hour to debate a lot of those issues that have come up this morning. And of course we'll be opening this section of the day up to the floor. I very much want to hear as many of your opinions and views and issues as possible. The issues that we want to discuss in the next hour are really, you know, what are the key issues, the issues that are really causing everyone the most concern when it comes to the issue of managing vine weevil? What are the options, what are our options available? And how can we work together as an industry to make sure that we have an effective strategy given the many, many challenges that we face? I'm going to begin, first of all, by putting one of the questions to the panel, and then when we've heard from the panel, then open up to the floor. And on the panel, as you will know from John's introduction, we have a really good mixture of both expert advisors, people representing manufacturers, distributors, growers, and retailers. So we really have got the whole range of the industry here on the panel. So just beginning with the panel, the first question we want to look at is, you know, really what are the biggest concerns that we face in our different sectors from our different perspectives? So if I could start with John and just ask, sorry, if I could start with John, can you just tell me what, from your point of view, what is it that keeps you up at night when you think about the issues that we're discussing this morning? What's the biggest concern?
Well, as you know, there are many things that keep a nursery awake at night. in the context of today, it is, and allow me to say this, it is the unknown. And by that I mean, as I said this morning, what are those little weevils doing while they're down the road here? I don't know.
They're plotting.
So first of all, Paul's absolutely right, they're plotting, they're cunning. Secondly, what tools have I got? Well, I've learned a lot today. So, yes, I've got an array of products. So then I have to say, well, as I said this morning, are they alive? I'm going to buy something, are they alive? Am I putting it on the right way? Having put them on, living organisms, are they doing their job? Have I put them on in the right places? As far as chemical control is concerned, what will I have tomorrow? Now, our friend here has said that there will be a product tomorrow after the cook. But I don't know what it is. So allow me just to say that, Kate, that if I know that crop there has got vine weevils, I know what to do. Yeah? Now I'll give you, can I go on then? I sometimes drive the lorry, one of the lorries. And I delivered to a customer in Yorkshire last spring, and I was about 20 minutes down the road. My phone went, so I stopped. And it was somebody from the office who got a phone call from the plant area manager to say that my conifers have got my weevils. Would I go back? Yeah? I would normally willingly go back, but I had a route to do and driver's hours and all the rest of it. So I said, look, we can't. But so I phoned Paul, my son, and I told him the situation. So he phoned the customer, and it was one plant. Yeah. That had fallen off the trolley, as he said, which when it fell off the trolley, the lad saw it. So Paul, my son, he went out, this was Tremors of Paris filled with silver, and he went out and he looked at all the children with silver, and he effectively checked the whole crop on these bears, never found another plan. So it's the unknown, yeah?
Thanks, John. Alistair.
Since I joined the industry where I'm working 20 years ago, we had a problem with vine weevil. We still have a problem with vine weevil, and we'll have a problem with vine weevil in 20 years' time if we don't learn within our own businesses and our own expertise to manage it. We're never going to totally eradicate it. We have been comfortable in periods of my 20 years within the business where we could put a pesticide in the container and thought that we got control, but we still didn't get control at that time. I think all as people running businesses, growing plants, it's for me, it's about detail. It's about knowing what to do, when to do it, keeping records of that, and also being flexible to change. So we've spoken about Met 52 and difficult or poor results with that. We've spoken about nematodes and poor results with that. It's to understand that these new controls that we've got are living organisms and knowing why that hasn't happened and improving that. If you're putting pesticide in the growing media, it's to keep a record of everything that you pot. I don't think there's very few nurseries that say, right, I'm going to put exemptor through the hole 100%. So you then pick which crops are susceptible. And for the best will in the world, it comes down to the weakest link. It's the guy who's putting the bale into the potting machine. You need to keep a record, and if that doesn't happen, then you know that come a certain period of time, you need to treat them. One of the a talk years and years ago, John here, two down from me, said, the time to be treating nematodes is August Bank Holiday. And for me, I always think that if you can put set points in a grower's calendar and then stick to them, that it makes it easy for everyone in the business to remember. Because we are all technically aware and want to do that here within this room. But we've got people in the nursery that John's worried about who are going to phone up and say, I've got one like vine weevil in this. So you've got to be able to, all of us be able to get that message across to the people that are doing the day in, day out job, from the distributors to us as technical managers, the owners of the business. Even simple things. I had a pet vine weevil for 2 years in an old camera film thing, and I took that round and showed everyone who was picking plants, if you see one of these, please can you report it to me on what crop you found it on and whereabouts. And it's about detail, and days like today is where that detail should hopefully be built upon.
Thanks, Alistair.
Marcus,
from a retail perspective.
What keeps us away? I honestly feel that it's having, eventually, not having anything that you can satisfy a customer with. We believe in customer service. I believe the customer comes to you to get customer service, and it's all about repeat business. And to me, it's becoming harder and harder for us as a retailer and a team to offer the customer something that they can get away and solve their problem with. And customers want answers. And I think the worrying thing for me is the day that we've got nothing on that shelf to offer. Customer that will work, and I'm not just saying something that we can offer them and push them out the door and send them off with a bottle of X. We've got to be genuine and offer them something that will actually solve their problem as a retailer. And the other bit that worries me is ensuring that we get the information from the manufacturers to our staff that's correct and fresh, and driving good internal training programs within the retail business for the help of the supplier, so they can share that information with the customer when they come in, and that the media support us all. And we're not all negative, and there's always a positive and a negative to everything, especially when we're sharing about diseases and pests out there in the amateur or any media, full stop.
Thanks, Marcus. Colin, from a manufacturer's perspective.
I guess really our main concern, well, not the concern really, is we're always keeping an eye on the changing regulatory environment, because the regulatory departments, they can quickly withdraw a product from sale, from the market. So that's why we're always keeping an eye on the requirements from the regulators, so that our products not only meet those environmental regulations, they surpass them. so that they're sort of future-proof. And the intent with that, I guess, really is, and this isn't to have a proper journalist, but it's possibly the misunderstanding or misrepresentation of certain chemical products, active ingredients available to you as end users. And the prime example, the elephant in the room, is neonicotinoids. So there are neonicotinoids and there are neonicotinoids. And for instance, we've heard about imidacloprid or thiacloprid, but in reality, they're like chalk and cheese. Thiacloprid is a third generation neonicotinoid, is a new one. It's classed as not dangerous to bees, which I can expand on a bit later if we want to further discuss neonicotinoids. But it's just that reporting of information relating to chemicals, insecticides, that if the full facts, the education isn't put across, people can easily misinterpret and get the wrong impression. So I think it's just education and monitoring changes in the regulatory environment are our sort of main or primary issues.
Well, also as a manufacturer, I guess things which keep us awake at night probably at the minute is the exchange rate, because we're a German company, so most of our stuff's in euros, but that aside, I think it's actually hearing our customers not having a satisfied use of our products. I think that's one of our biggest things, because we strongly believe in what we have, and we would like to feel that people get the control and efficacy out of our products that they believe they should get. So for us, it's a little bit back to the comment before. It's understanding our customers, which is mainly distribution, but then beyond that, it's understanding you guys, because you are ultimately our final customer. And so hearing stuff come back that you're not satisfied with stuff, that's what keeps us awake at night. And developing our products, or trying to understand how to develop our products to make them work better. Because ultimately, we can spend years playing around and developing a product, but it's not really until you guys get hold of it that we actually really learn how these things work.
Thank you. So Andrew, from your point of view, what's the biggest concern?
I think for me, it's how we justify the use of our products to control the serious pests of the sort of the wider media and the public in general, so that retailers feel confident enough, to stock some of the products that customers can use, manufacturers feel confident enough to launch products that can help the final consumer, and the fact that we can get our soundbite across in a reasonable way into a soundbite that says this is really important, we're not harming bees, we're not doing this, and it's important to the industry. I think that's what we'd like to get across.
Very lovely, thank you. And
Paul. Thank you, Carol. I suppose for me, it's product development. I spent 25 years, more than 25 years now, working on vine weevil controls. First of all, I did some work with Aldrin back in the mid 80s. Probably doesn't count as development. Then Suscon in Middlesex, Met 52, granular. We're now looking forward, what have we got coming? We've got Met52OD, we're working with azadirachtin, which is a botanical biopesticide. We're working with traps, we're working with attractants, we're working with traps which combine attractants and control measures. But you don't do that on your own. You don't do that on your own at all. I mean, we've collaborated over all of those products. We go back to Suscon, we did an awful lot with ADAS, John Buxton at the time. We did a lot with the manufacturer of the product, which is an Australian company, and it's through collaboration that we come up with new products. So we're currently working with Swansea University, with FIRA, with Forest Research, with ADAS, AHDB, a whole host of organisations, because those silver bullets don't exist anymore and they won't be coming back. So Suscon Green, Vinyl, long gone. We won't have those sorts of tools back. Those were very forgiving. You could mix them in the growing media. To a large extent, it didn't really matter quite how well you mixed it. They would still work. They're very robust, very persistent, very active. Those days are gone. We are going to have to learn to work with a number of tools, each of which
might provide 50, 60, if we're lucky 80, 90% control. We're not going to get 100% control products, so we're going to have to learn how to integrate those products and those tools. And that means working together. That means us working with BASF, working with other organisations, working with ADAS to develop programmes. It's integrated pest management. And that's what this is, the future is. Not just for vine weevil, but for all pest and disease control. You know, the time will come when you won't have chemicals which will knock out powdery mildew like that. You're going to have to use a whole host of different products. It's exactly the same with vine weevil. And perhaps vine weevil's at the forefront of that. You're going to have to learn to use different tools. And that means knowing what's going on your nursery. What's happening, intelligence. That's the basis of any good control. Knowing what's happening, looking, where is it happening, how bad is it, what's being affected. What are my tools available? How do those tools work? Where are they best used? How can I put them into a program? All of that's come together, and that's going to put a lot more demands on you as growers to understand what is actually happening on your nursery, to understand the products and the tools that you have available and how to pull them together. So I think anybody here whose job title is technical manager is probably quite safe. You've probably got a good future ahead of you, pulling all of these tools together. And we're going to need ADAS, we're going to need AHDB, we're going to need all of these guys here to come together. And I think that's the theme that we've been following right the way through.
Thanks, Paul. Jude, your perspective?
I'd like to follow on from what Paul was saying, really, in looking to the future. In order to do this product development and developing new options for control of vine weevil and other pests, my biggest fear is the funding buying up to do this research, really. I mean, I've been with ADAS for 35 years. When I first started, we were part of the Ministry of Agriculture, and the funding automatically came to us because we were part of MAP. Now I spend a lot of my time, maybe a quarter, a third of my time, writing research proposals, not doing the research, but trying to get funding. And the sources of funding are getting, you know, more difficult to get hold of. DEFRA funding's much more reduced now. So AHDB Horticulture are one of the main sources of funding for coming up with practical results and new results to keep, you know, coming up with new options and to face new challenges and alien pests coming in and that sort of thing. So I would say keep paying your levy, and I hope we can still keep coming up with the answers for you in the future.
Okay, thanks, Jude. Right, I'd like to open up to, and be grateful if whoever would like to speak, if you can sort of say your names, that would be great. So, who would like to speak first?
Hello, I'm Caroline Reed from Bioline Agrosciences. We are a biological control production company, and we distribute the nematodes. I'd just like to follow on from what something Alistair said. Alistair said that pest control, vine weevil control in this case, is controlled by the weakest link. I believe that in some cases staff don't believe how important pest control is in a nursery situation. They see it as something quite low down the list, and we know that's not the case. John, I think, implied that he actually applies chemicals himself at night to make sure that they're done properly. We believe that nematodes do work. We use them in many crops, and they work almost 100% in a lot of cases. And I'd like to say, as long as we put them on properly, at the right time, and use them correctly, store them correctly, they will work. We work very closely with BASF, who produce all the nematodes, including Nemesis L. And if any of you do want somebody to come out to your nurseries, we can go through the programs. We can make sure that whatever crops you've got, they're being applied properly on. We know they're not the cheapest route, but if they work at the end of the day, that's what matters. Therefore, if any of you need any information on nematodes, there's several of us here who can, including Fargro, who also supply nematodes. There's several of us here who can actually give you information, and we're more than happy to come out and maybe tell you about things that you maybe knew about in the back of your heads, but it looks like some things aren't right at the front of your minds, like the fact that Nemesis L stands for low temperature. So that's what I'd like to say.
Okay, thanks very much.
Can I ask a question of people that supply the nematodes and scientists? Is there anything else, I'm thinking like a mealworm that we can buy from a fishing shop, that the nematodes would attack that we could use as a marker? Because one of the things is that you went over the top of the crop. You might have found one or two, or in the history, you think there's a possibility in there. I'm always quite keen to start as early as possible, not wait until it gets down to the cold temperature, to start early, and then you're not fighting against a change of weather. But then the thing is, you've got to destroy crops to find a vine weevil larvae. Then you say, oh, it looks a little bit sick, but is it dying? We're used to putting a drench on and finding it in the old times as pesticide. So is there something that we can go down, buy some maggots or some mealworm, put into a petri dish with some growing media in amongst the crop, drench the crop, then take them out and put them in the boss's office or in your area cupboard or somewhere, that will then give us a good pointer that we've got control?
Okay, we actually do that same, sorry. Anita from BASF, and we actually do that exact same method. So we polish to control every single batch of nematodes that goes out, and we use mealworms. We do exactly that. We put them in a media, we apply the nematodes on it, and we use it as a marker. That's an excellent idea.
Yeah. So we could put that in our crop.
Absolutely.
And then you know that we've got a result quicker than waiting till.
Yeah, that's great.
Okay. Can I just say, before we move on to more discussion about the options and solutions, can I just go back to the original question again and just see, just from the audience, you know, what are your biggest concerns? What's, you know, about this whole issue and the management of this, you know, particular pest? What's your biggest worry? What do you see as the biggest challenge?
Thank you. Martin Emmett, AHGB, Chair of Winterthur. Our sponsors before lunch suggested that actually we might have an opportunity with leaving the EU, but I actually suspect that we're going to see a rather different climate. I think with the neonics, for example, I think we might see our environmentalist bodies actually become more emboldened and stronger. So that would be one concern for me. But also not just to neonics, I think there's a whole lot of supplementary issues we're not even aware of at the moment, where we might find environmentalists have an issue with our control strategies. The second thing which really worries me is that this could have become primarily an issue for the ornamentals industry, because we're seeing large volumes of strawberries, for example, going from field into more hydroponic type systems. And although, yes, there could still be a vine weevil problem, I don't think it's happening on quite the same scale. So the AHDB work we've been talking about, HNS 195, for example, that's funded wholly by the nursery stock panel. You know, we might have opened in an environment where the panel sort of seems like priority. So that I think that's a real risk. This could become primarily an issue for the ornamentals industry.
Okay, thank you. Any more thoughts? Yes.
Wayne Ruff, HDB. It's kind of a statement of question. I do worry, given we've heard people saying that they're only going to achieve 80-90% control about the management of the pest in the supply chain. So I do apologise for this, Marcus, but how do you feel you can sort of educate and manage the expectation of your customers if there are going to be potentially groups in growing media or product going forward?
Thank you.
Sorry.
Manage the expectation, because I think it's down to communication. I believe customer service is about communicating with the customer. An element of what we offer our customers is advice, and I think you have to train your staff, and that's going to have to come with some help from our suppliers of our retail product, to share the knowledge with the customer about how the changes have happened, or the fact that chemicals aren't around, or you know, our growers can only achieve X percentage because that's what they only have available for them. And it's sharing that information through all of our teams, from the grower to the retailer and to their staff, that are definitely talking to the customers so they feel confident in sharing that information. Ultimately, the answer would be we want to sell the best product that's physically available on the market to the customer, so they guarantee that they get the best from their £10.99 purchase. But I think obviously at the end of the day, perhaps we've got to be realistic. That's you know, where I believe we will be going.
Thanks, Marcus. Okay, any more? Are there any other areas that we haven't touched on? Any other sort of areas of concern that we haven't brought out yet? There's a hand over there.
This is a very practical question. This is a very, Ian Nelson, John Sewitty. This is a very practical question for the esteemed panel. What would be the very best indicator card to put out on the nursery to know whether you had an issue or not? And what would be the ideal coverage per 100 square metres of this indicator card?
I think, Ian, it probably depends on whether you're looking for the adult or the larvae. I mean, where you've got large leaf plants like begonias and things like that are very good at showing up notches. Hosta's another one for showing up notches in adults. Where you've got larvae, then it's a different matter altogether. Well, the large leaf plants where you can easily see a notching. Anyone got any other suggestions for hostas or begonias?
Yeah, I mean, we've had growers who use euonymus, for example, because it's very easy to see the notches in the leaves there. And they also show up, as I said earlier, root stress, so it's an indication of larvae. But as Jude was just mentioning, something cheap and cheerful, something like a primula.
Yeah, we've used primulas quite a lot. They weren't as attractive as I expected them to be.
The problem is, if you put an attractive plant within a block of plants that are already attractive, we don't know how far vine weevil move, we don't know what the attractions are. You know, this is one of the big gaps in vine weevil knowledge, that there's quite a bit of work being done at Swansea University at the moment looking at attractants and repellents, and over 3 years still not really nailed what is attractive and how that attraction works in different crops. Because if you've got something that's very attractive and you put it in a crop that isn't attractive, it's probably going to work extremely well. But if you stick it in a crop that is already attractive, or then it won't work well. So it's the relative balance of that. And at the moment, we're a long way from having something that we can reliably say is attractive to vine weevil and will work in all environments. The ADAS project is going to be looking at some of that work. But I mean, Rob van Tol in the Netherlands has been working on this since, I think 92, 93 was the first time I had communication with them, on and off. And there are other groups around the world that have tried to look at this. And at the moment, we don't have reliable attractions. But going back to the original question, John is right. Anything with a broadleaf that you can easily see the notches on is worth having. And something like primula, which is very susceptible, it collapses quite quickly with larvae. It's cheap, you can easily have a look and see if the larvae are there.
I think, if I could just add, the problem we find with putting marker plants on around the nursery is that they generally don't grow, or they're not looked after, or they get tidied away, unless you get the story out to everyone. But in our experience, in our crop, fritillas are probably the earliest sign for adult notching. But if you put primula, what size pot do you put in? And amongst a 3-litre crop that's being watered overhead, and how do you stop somebody from throwing it away because they think it's a weed or gapping it up? It's about the management. We don't tend to use marker crops.
Okay,
clarify. I'd just like to add that Tom Pope is actually going to be looking at indicator plants in our AHDB project, so alongside looking at different types of traps for refuges and things, he will actually be looking at trap plants. So I've made a note of all those suggested plants because he'll be starting that work over the next month or so.
Is there anybody else having any experience of this? Any other growers who have any useful feedback?
Whatever you use as an indicator plant, use it. And just put it out there and walk away and forget where it is. Have it on a weekly monitoring schedule. Have a staff member who's responsible for walking around that nursery, checking on those plants, have them numbered, have them plotted, so that you can record the numbers and you've got somebody who's taking responsibility for it. Because as I said earlier, yellow sticky traps are a real bugbear of mine. Go up in March, come down in October, nobody's looked at them in the meantime, waste of time and money. You can have exactly the same if you use indicator plants if you don't use them properly. They are there as a monitoring tool. You need to go back weekly, record, look after them. Otherwise you're wasting time and money, you might as well not do it.
I think if anything, Paul, it's worse, because in this particular scenario, the monitor plant becomes a banker plant.
Yeah.
If you're not monitoring them, you end up building the population back up again.
You could do, yeah. And it's a lot more expensive than sticky.
Just to add one thing in, I put a reward on our technical manager for finding adult vine weevils, and he came in regularly with a torch at night with his wife and found quite a few. And that was £2 an adult. he found a very nice picture of where they were. So
did he get recycled?
No. But see, you lose a plant that's more than £2, isn't it?
Sure.
Okay, so the
gentleman
at the back.
My name is Bill Godfrey. I'm concerned that we lose sight of the fact this is a wild animal. So, for example, if a retail planter is buying a plant that's been protected from vine weevil with nematodes, they plant it in their garden, and the natural population that seems to be in everybody's garden that I see infects it, so the poor old garden centre gets it in the neck. Alistair suggested that he targets his compost incorporated insecticide. In my experience, that can be a mistake because there's quite a lot of genera which act as hosts of vine weevil, but at a subclinical level. So unless you actually knock them out and look at them, you've no idea that you're, going back to Wayne's point, providing a banker for the pest. The other thing is generally there's a lot of ignorance about it. We supply only the landscape sector, but if you look at living walls, specifying asplenium, hedera, whatever, all of which are very good host of vine weevil. And finally, I really like what Andrew said this morning, I think we also need to look at our production techniques and use the other piece of control that hasn't been mentioned, which is the skip. So we've gone to we're a herbaceous grower, but we've got a 9-month production cycle starting in the new year, stopping at the beginning of September, and incorporating exemptor to try and cover the vine weevil larvae and the hatching period.
Okay, thank you.
Mike Norris, New Place Nesteries. Just a general comment to answer your question, Kate, regarding concern. I think as I look down through the list of delegates who are here, and think of the number of millions of plants that are produced, if we accept as an industry an 80 to 90% efficacy or control, that's 10% of a large volume of product that will be released to the retail sector. That will be infected with vine weevil and subsequently disappoint a consumer or a gardener, which is effectively what we're all here to supply. So I think we should be working as an industry in supporting research to come up with 100% control and be
just on that, that kind of takes us quite nicely into the next area that we need to talk about, which is, you know, what else can we do as an industry? You know, what are the most helpful things that the industry can do working together? Does anybody else want to, you know, any more thoughts on that? Or indeed on any of the other topics that have been raised? Yes?
Very briefly, I'd like to point in strawberry production, the longest period for control achievable with no easy with is 18 months. In other words, we recommend that people reintroduce nematodes as early as the soil temperatures allow at the start of the season following the one in which they were first introduced. So typically September 2013 to May 2015 is about as long as you could ask a retail customer to expect their crops to be safe.
Can I just say, with regards to that, you've heard now a couple of times mentioned about 80% control. That's a minimum requirement set by the regulatory authorities, not a maximum. So you would get at least 80% control. And as I said earlier, Bayer as a manufacturer, we aim to produce our products which surpass the regulatory requirements. So you would invariably get far more than that 80% control with a product, you know, from a manufacturer, in most cases, as I say, we always look to surpass those requirements from the regulatory authorities. And it's just to remember that it's 80% is the minimum amount to qualify as control, not the maximum.
Yes,
yeah.
Oh, yes,
the
gentleman
there,
and then
Paul Masters, nurseryman from Suffolk. Somebody, I think it's Alistair, with his night hunting technical manager, out looking for vine weevil. My garden at home has a very healthy population of hedgehogs. We don't have a problem with vine weevil at home. We do have a problem with vine weevil occasionally on the nursery. I don't have any hedgehogs on the nursery, as I'm aware of. Has there been any research done with other things that eat vine weevil? Chickens, when I last looked, go to sleep at night.
I mean, there was some work done by EMR a few years ago on the impacts of ground beetles on vine weevils, which are natural predators of other insects, including vine weevils. So there are other natural predators around as well. And we actually did a survey as part of a DEFRA funding project with John Buxton, I remember, some years ago. And we surveyed nursery stock standing out areas on various nurseries with pitfall traps. And we found a surprising amount, even on a nursery that was using pesticides, and loads of different predatory beetles on site. Don't underestimate what's going on out there that you're not aware of.
I do wonder whether a lot of the problem in gardens is because there are fewer hedgehogs. Most modern gardens aren't very hedgehog friendly. Perhaps there's an education opportunity there.
That may well be the case. The other thing to remember is that in soil, you'll have fungi, you'll have bacteria, you'll have nematodes, you'll have various beetle larvae, all of which will have an impact on vine weevil at different stages. Shrews are a great predator for adult vine weevil, for example. But what we're talking about is a holiday home for vine weevil that you're creating. You've got a nice pot, well looked after plant. There's no natural enemies in that pot, there's no natural fungi, there's no natural bacteria, no natural nematodes. If you wanted to design a system to breed vine weevil, it would be a nursery. So we're having to put those things back in, some form of control measure, that isn't there in that situation, which is in your garden. There's a whole host of control measures in the garden.
They don't exist on nurseries. So we have a very artificial environment. It's a holiday home for vine weevil.
Thanks, Paul. I'm waiting patiently to speak.
Thanks, Merlin Brooker, the Nicholson Nursery. Just to pick up on nemesis and the nematodes, I think a lot of it is about confidence. And as a grower, I've noticed the price of it has shot up because a lot of people are now using it. And I feel that the supporting literature with that product and the advice whilst it's out there, which is lovely to hear that you're on the end of the phone, and I know John's on the end of the phone, and people phone up with sort of outlandish questions. I'm sure those questions keep coming up from lots of people. You know, I may have 2 cubic meters of water in my room now in the nursery. At what point do I know that's flowed through? Because I've got expensive nematodes in the system. How wet does wet mean if your pot has to be wet before it goes on? How wet should it be afterwards? What effect does a dosage one have? You know, today we had about 20 bar, was the first time I heard 20 bar was okay. So maybe that's really been ignorant, but it seems like there are a lot of sort of corollaries to using it that are not out there for everybody. So I think possibly the information that comes with those nematodes should be more industry focused, perhaps.
Okay, thanks very much.
Well, I'd just like to say that, as Wayne said earlier, I just updated the old HGC vine weevil fact sheet, and in that I have included pretty much all the recommendations for using nematodes, taking recommendations from all the different suppliers. So hopefully I have brought together everything in that. Hopefully when that comes out, it will be available to everybody.
The point you made about, do I know if all my cider water's gone through? Stick some food dye in. Put food dye in with your nematodes. Won't harm them. But you'll see when that's gone through the dripper, and you'll see much stuff coming through the dripper.
Can I
swap
and then sprinkle him?
Hello. I'm Inshad from Biovina Limited. I have more than 20 years experience in nematode and fungus. I was a family researcher, but 2 years before I became an entrepreneur. So we are handling everything in a new biopesticide product, and hopefully that will be coming by 2020 or 2021. Now, in between, we have developed some hash cow. The two posters are actually like, one is about the company, the other one is about the training program. I heard about the panel and the concern from the growers. So we designed a training program, how to use the biopesticide. And that's where I have been looking this one for the last few years. You go to the growers, you talk to them, and there is a problem, the technical. So we are inviting many technical directors, supervisors, and the managers. They are coming, and we are teaching them how to use the nematodes. Nematodes are brilliant, but there is a problem. How to keep them alive, the transportation problem is there. How many, earlier we were talking about the nematodes are in the pack. Then we have a quality marker. We have developed the quality marker. How to identify them, and how to apply the best way in conjunction with the growers. So that's the area actually we are looking now. We have done a lot of training program in the UK, in the European country, and in Africa. And I think that's what we need to do here in the UK. Thank you.
Thank you so much. I think just moving on to what we need to do as an industry. I mean, clearly there does seem to be a theme about communication there, which has come up across a whole load of sectors, both in terms of communications within the nursery, communications with customers, and so on. But I'd quite like to sort of move to the panel, just ask the panel in terms of the strategies that the industry can be working on together. Can I start to gather some of your thoughts on that? Who'd like to go first?
Well, today is a prime example. We've got industry bodies and manufacturers, representatives, have all come together to discuss a specific problem. And I think it's more taking something like this Vine Weevil Summit further forward with education. But for the whole bunch, as I say, there's no one product really that should be used. It should be using an integrated approach. So if we can then push that forward, not only to growers, to retailers, but to end users, so they know what goes into producing a product. and what is carried out behind the scenes to give them a pest-free, disease-free, good specimen plant. So I think more events like this and perhaps a committee of some sort which ensures that all stakeholders within the industry are kept in touch with each other. And so this is a very good first step, I think.
Yeah, I mean, I would sort of mirror that, really. I think for us in industry, it's getting the information back and trying to understand what your problems are, and that is only going to happen through communication, be it through AHDB or direct contact. But I think that is key, is to keep the communication flow moving.
I would just say, take time to learn, to find out information. Most of the manufacturers, all these products here, there's a lot more information on websites that doesn't appear on product labels. Product labels on pesticides are the regulated text. You can't put anything more, anything less on a label than what the regulator allows you to. But most of us will put much more information on websites. So, for example, in MET52, there's 8 pages of technical notes that ask questions about the product, how best to use it, best way to use it. In our little booklet here, we just put a few questions in the back, the sorts of questions that you should be asking yourselves when you're planning your control program. Yeah, there's an example of a control program here, month by month, but that won't suit everybody, it won't suit all of you, but those questions, some of those points there, are what you should be thinking about. So what I would say to you is take some time, perhaps this winter, when things are a little bit quieter, to look at your options, to ask the suppliers, what further information is available? What is behind the label? Because there's a lot there that you can learn and you can use. Make use of your consultants. I mean, John's a fantastic source of information. And there are other consultants around as well. It's not just John. So gather that information together. Don't wait until you've got a problem. My last slide said plan, act, review. That's what you should be doing, not just with Vine Weevil, but with everything, but particularly with Vine Weevil. Gather your information, take time, gather it together, find out what suits you best.
Okay, any more thoughts on John?
Can I just make one suggestion that we are very much governed by publicity and the media at whole, and you can imagine, can't you, a red top headline, Vine Weevil killed my marriage or something. And we were sort of subject to some of these dramatic statements. And there's a degree where probably we'll never be totally 100% free of vine weevil in what we dispatch. We can try our best, we can do all we can. And sometimes I wonder if we should raise the bar a little in terms of what's allowed. And that might be difficult for Marcus's Mrs. Jones in 35 Acacia Avenue. But sometimes, you know, you get a 15 or a 20 litre tree that's got vine weevil, and people say, you know, what do I do? And I say, so what? You know, it's got masses of root, vine weevil can live there. And sometimes we may need to be a little bit more tolerant of it, rather than accept, we cannot accept it full stop. Maybe we should be thinking about some publicity and some way in which we can educate people to say, low levels, I mean, we're talking about 2 million plants. 0.5% of vine weevil is still 10,000 plants of 2 million plants. You know, we've got 0.5%, 99.995% control, but that could still mean 10,000 plants out of 2 million. Maybe we should be thinking a little about accepting a lower level, or a slightly higher level, should I say, than we have at the moment.
I'd just like to say, you know, there's a lot of information. I think the key is to act on the information. So many times, there's a lot of information being presented, so it's important to go away and review what you're doing and act, but also the communication to your customers about what you're doing, and I think that can only help going up the retailer chain and help with their explanation to the public.
I was just going to say, from a retailer's view, I think it's, as I've said earlier, it's as a plant buyer, it's understanding where your product's coming from and understanding the nursery, and that's communicating not just with the sales account manager, the technical managers, etc. They're growing the plants, and also it's that sharing of information, especially for the retail product from our suppliers and the manufacturers of retail chemicals or product that is physically going to be available to the consumer.
Thanks, Marcus.
And
a
broader
perspective on the industry you're doing?
I will make a comment. This information has been here. We've worked on it for years and years, but we've still got a room full of growers here who are still worried about it. As I mentioned before, it's about the weakest link in the whole setup. John's worried what the vine weevil are doing, I'm worried what my staff are doing when I'm not there. It's about trying to make this good science and product as usable for most of the people in the nursery, or for the technical side of things. For me, it's all about remembering key points to do things, so you don't have to be, because we're all busy, we get very busy during certain times of the year, but it's to make sure that once you pass that day, you need to be doing something. A scenario for me, on our nursery, we know not to prune brooms after the longest day. So everyone on the nursery knows when you start getting up to June the 21st, if you haven't pruned the brooms, why haven't you done them? And maybe it should be, once you go past August bank holiday, you should be doing nematodes. Or Met 52 hasn't worked because of so-and-so. It needs to be something that everyone in this room can have a diary point that they can do. And it's with sometimes, as growers, I think, yes, you're on the end of the phone, but we're busy, we're complaining to suppliers about so-and-so and stuff. So it's to try and make something more usable for everyone in the trade.
Okay, well, we're nearly out of time, but time for one or two last points.
Can I just make a comment, Alistair? If we all go and write August bank holiday, you're dying. I think that probably might be a little bit early if you're only going to put on one application, because vine weevils can lay their eggs well into September or even October, depending on the temperature. And we've had some very warm autumns lately. So if you're going to put it on then, I would always put it on maybe 4 weeks later. I mean, maybe it really depends on temperatures, really, and which nematode you're using, obviously, because you can go later in the season with Steinemann
McCrasy,
so don't all just stick to August bank holiday.
Yeah, I understand. It's about making it. The more parameters, and I know there are lots of parameters, the more complicated you make it, the less likely it is for people to do.
Okay, are there any last burning points or questions? Yes.
Marcus, how do you think your customers would react to knowing that the plants that potentially you could sell them would have biopesticide in? So you were talking about communication, maybe the potential of labelling a plant that has an F52 in or something like that. Would that be a positive thing, or is that going to discourage them from buying a product?
I think you've got two customers. You've got some that have got the thing about pesticides full start, and you've got some that it wouldn't make an ounce of difference. And I think it's down to what we have to do by law, or what it's recommended by our chemical manufacturer, and how long it's going to be on the business as well, isn't it? It's how long has it been growing at Rochester before it was delivered to Aylett's? How long is it going to sit on us? So I do think it's not carte blanche, yes or no, across the thing. I think it all depends on customers. It depends on the product that you're retailing and the product that's in the media.
Harry Ferrucci retreat. It strikes me, and it would be very helpful in my case, I'm a grower, that it would be much easier to have a central point of contact. I always feel it's very easy for businesses and organisations to put all their information on the website, but there are hundreds of growers, and all hundreds of growers have to go through every website, and you don't know where to go, and things are always getting updated, and there's great work always going on. I really feel genuinely we'd better have a much more of a single point of contact where we could go, at least for the main bullets. And I wonder really, after today's great effort, which is really good to get everybody together, the best brains all here. And clearly, I know very little compared to a lot of people. I thought I was reasonably okay on it, but how is it going to go forward? And is somebody, in fact, going to take a lead on this? I wonder what you think.
We are setting up an HTA portal, Jill, and I would think it would be, I raised the question looking towards her, I would think it would be possible for us to put on much of the sort of points and the web pages and things onto that portal with a Vine Weevil tag on it, if that would help. We could certainly have a go at setting that up.
So I think we're out of time now, but thank you all very much for your points and questions, and it'd be great if you could sort of join me just thanking our panel. I think we've done a fantastic job. So thanks very much.